Thank you very much. Let me first thank the Pontifical Academy and CNRE for inviting me to give this talk. I'm very happy to be here with you in this meeting. Well, my presentation really follows very closely the earlier presentation by Loretto and also this last presentation by Ricarboni. But I would really focus on the problems of food security and climate-smart agriculture in Africa. So this is just an outline of what I'm going to talk about the challenges, opportunities, and how to promote climate-smart agriculture in Africa and the building capacities. The challenges are, of course, obvious to many people here. First of all, Africa, for those who don't know, the size of Africa is really a huge continent. You can put China, USA, India, the whole of Europe, Japan, and a little bit more, all fit into Africa. So it's really a huge continent with a population of 1.2 billion people. Poverty is rampant, 70% live on less than $2 a day. Malnutrition in all its forms is not only undernutrition, but also micronutrient deficiency and obesity are also found in Africa. Energy is a very serious problem, and I will say a few words about that later, because we have 65% of the population not having electricity. And water is also another challenge, 40% have no access to safe drinking water. And of course, climate change. This is a serious problem for Africa as well. So all these real-life problems are encapsulated into the Sustainable Development Goals that we talked about earlier today. But for Africa, the achieving the goals that relate to agriculture and relate to climate action are really central. And I'm talking about the goals 1, 2, 3, 7 in particular for agriculture, and of course the Sustainable Development Goals 13 for the climate. Well, Africa is most vulnerable to climate change, and that's why climate is so important, climate action is so important for Africa, although it doesn't contribute to emissions, simply because it has very fragile ecosystem, and it has weak infrastructure and adaptation capacity. And for example, climate change increases droughts, heat stress, floods, and food insecurity in Africa. And one big problem that Africa has is this enormous amount of dust that is released every year from the Sahara. And this is what NOAA, a couple of years ago, called it the new carbon dioxide, which is really now becoming very serious in warming of the Atlantic Ocean. At the same time, you have a large amount of this dust being transported all the way and deposited in the Amazon forest. And this is what, in many ways, helping the Amazon forest to be green and prosperous because of the richness of the topsoil that is released from the Sahara, including phosphorus and also potassium. So these are huge nutrients that are very, very relevant to the Amazon. So you see this coupling. And unfortunately, Africa is not getting any money for this dust that has been very useful to the Amazon. It's losing a lot of it, but not getting any reward. Opportunities are enormous in Africa. Natural resources, of course, is a huge opportunity for Africa to exploit these natural resources in, of course, a sustainable and rational manner. Africa, for example, has 14 classes of ecological zones and with a wide variety ranging from dry desert to humid rainforest with the rare indigenous food and medicinal plants and a wealth of associated traditional knowledge. And Africa, for those who don't know, has over 60% of uncultivated arable land in the world. So it really has the potential not to feed Africa itself, but perhaps to feed the world. The human capital, this again is a huge resource. Africa is, as I said, home to 1.2 billion people, but over 60% of them are under the age of 25. So imagine how you can actually make use of the youth. If you provide them with the right education and the right opportunities, this is really a huge asset for the continent. The policy framework has been done, and has been done very carefully by the African leaders in the African Union, and the political commitment for agriculture and how to move forward with specific recommendations. This is all in place now. And in fact, the harmonization of the Agenda 2063 that has been designed by the African Union and the 2030 Agenda, the Sustainable Development Goals, that harmonization has taken place through negotiations with the African Union, and that has produced a document, a very beautiful document that that calls for coordination and harmonization and even implementation of the two agendas. So everything is in place. But as was said earlier, where is the political will and the political action to do that? This is a problem that we have. Now let me come to climate smart agriculture. Climate smart agriculture, as was explained to us very nicely by Loreto, is really a mechanism of transforming agricultural systems to achieve food security under climate change by first increasing the productivity, and this is of course very much needed in Africa, the building the resilience and adaptation, and reducing the greenhouse gases. Agriculture, by the way, contributes 14% of the global greenhouse gases, whereas deforestation and land use contributes to 17%. So that's why the coupling of the two is really very important to address. It's very pleasing to see that in COP23, for the first time, and that was a real success, agreement to include agriculture in future discussions on climate action has been reached. That was really a landmark for agriculture. And the applications of frontier science, technology, and innovation are really essential in developing and sustaining climate smart agriculture, especially for Africa. And I would really like to give you some examples where this is now coming to Africa slowly but surely. For example, the information and communication technologies, these are really very important. We're beginning to see the benefit of the information and communication technologies to the farmers, providing them with instant access to market, information for informed decision about the place and time to sell their products, but at the same time also providing information on crop growth, on moisture, on minerals and nutrients and so on. And the drones are invading Africa at the same time, and especially the farming system in Africa. They are now being used widely, even in my own country, Sudan. Some large-scale farmers are also using them because they are very important for precision agriculture, for collecting important data and important information. And the use of big data in agriculture is also a very important issue for Africa. Agricultural biotechnology, with all the major issues and controversy related to agricultural biotechnology, it is now finding its way in Africa. Luckily, after so many years of resistance, you will find some countries now moving in that direction. The most important action I can say here is in Uganda, that relates to banana. Bananas in Uganda are a very, very important crop. And by the way, Uganda is the second largest country in the world in the production of bananas. And it is number one in consuming bananas, consumption per capita. Uganda is by far bigger than any other country in the world. So for them, this crop is very important. And several years ago, that crop was destroyed. 70% of it was destroyed by this bacterial wilt. And now they have developed a GMO type of banana, and this is going to be in full operation, I think, starting from next year. Agricultural genomics. This is, many of you might know, this is a new agricultural revolution that is driven by bioinformatics, plant and animal genome sequencing and editing. It is introducing a new breeding technique that can actually revolutionize the way that genome editing is conducted using this CRISPR-Cas9. And this could really transform plant breeding in Africa and help smallholder farmers to achieve food and nutrition security. And the good thing about it is that it's simple, it's affordable, and it's scalable. So this for Africa is really like a gold mine. I think Bill Gates is very much in favor of this. And he wrote an article recently about how important this is for food security in the poor countries. But of course, the controversy will still remain. In the United States, this is not only accepted, but they are arguing that this is really not GMO. This is just like fast conventional breeding. They're just doing it faster than what nature does. Whereas in Europe, still there is resistance that this is another type of GMO. But I think science and technology can settle this dispute. Renewable energy technologies are really fundamental. As I mentioned earlier, about 60% of Africans do not have electricity. And the only way out of that, because most of them are in rural areas, far away from the national grid, the only way out of that is to use renewable energies. And we're beginning to see this. We're beginning to see them really coming to the rural areas. So the energy, for example, you see examples here for water pumps, for drinking and for drip irrigation. Solar electricity for home, for school, for communication, and for food storage, cold storage. The cold storage and food preservation is very important in Africa. We know that post-harvest loss is everywhere in the world, and the statistics show that about 30% of the food that is produced, post-harvest food, is actually lost. But in Africa, one of the main reasons why post-harvest food is lost is because of the absence of cold storage. And that's why one way of doing that is to use renewable energies. The good thing about the solar energy and renewables, especially the solar energy, is that the cost is really declining. And at the same time, the efficiency is increasing. So there is a lot of hope there. But we would like, we in Africa would like also to be engaged in the production of solar cells and in the production and in making solar energy cheaper. So that's important. And that brings me to the capacity building, because I think it is so central for Africa and its development partners to strengthen and sustain capacity of research and higher education institutions in the continent. Two, attract, to train, and retain the best students in climate-smart agriculture. And I say that because agriculture is not an attractive profession for the young people. It isn't. I mean, you go to any young person or graduate of university that would like to go and work in the farm. We'll say no. But I think my feeling is that with the introduction of these new technologies that I just described, it can be very attractive for the young people to enroll in agricultural work, in agriculture and also in farming profession. The second is to develop, adapt, and deploy frontier science and technology and innovation to achieve food security. So it's a development, adaptation, and deployment. And the third is to scale up innovations in climate-smart agriculture and bring them to market. And the fourth is to empower farmers and link them to markets and consumers. So one way of course, in enhancing our capacities in Africa is to use what we call the centers of excellence. And fortunately, Africa does have a good number of international centers of excellence working in areas related to agriculture. And I've just listed some of them here. They're doing excellent work, but they need to expand their programs in capacity building, and they need to do more than what they're doing now. But the important capacity building initiative finally came from the World Bank. This is just a few years ago, I think three years ago. And the World Bank launched this enormous and very successful program in partnership with African governments to develop and sustain excellence in postgraduate education. So what they do here is to launch a huge competitive program, merit-based competitive program, asking universities in Africa to apply in specific areas, for example, health, energy, agriculture, ICT, selected areas. And they select the areas. Every year, they have a cluster of these areas. And the applicants are selected on the basis of merit, and if a university or a university department wins the competition, they get about $8 million to strengthen their research and postgraduate education. The good thing about this is that it's a joint venture with the government. And the well, it is not a grant. And this is, I think in my view, this is a positive thing. It's not a grant, because the country that agrees to participate in this program, they have to ask for a loan from the World Bank. It's true that it is a soft loan. It is from ODA. But at least there is a government commitment there to strengthen their own universities. And this is something we have never seen before. We've seen grants coming, not being sustained. But hopefully, this type of mechanism will sustain the operation. And one of those centers that have been selected in Ethiopia deals with climate smart agriculture, which you can see over there. So finally, I just want to reiterate what Riccarboni just said. I think if you want to achieve climate smart agriculture and really to make a difference, I've just described the science and technology innovations, which are very important, are very essential. But if you really want to scale the operation, as Riccarboni said, you must also consider other types of innovations. You must consider the business innovation to provide the business model, the social innovation so that people can accept that, and the governance also is innovation. So this sort of integrated innovation, in my view, is so essential and central for climate smart agriculture. With this, I thank you.